It's the biggest, they say, the most beautiful, the most awe-inspiring, the most colorful, the most spectacular event of this era, the New York World's Fair. In a word, it's the greatest.
It's hi-ho and off to the World's Fair in this episode of Details. Our journey begins in Flushing Meadows, New York. The Empire State was proud to welcome back the World's Fair to the same site they had held the 1939-1940s Fair.
Trains are easy to catch anywhere,
anytime, night or day.
Just pay 15 cents,
hop aboard,
and you're on your way. Yes, part of the fun of the World's Fair
is the subway special
that takes you there.
New York was also one of the 24 states boasting their own pavilion at the World's Fair. In fact, the New York Pavilion's observation decks were two of the highest points at the fair, giving guests an incredible view of the entire fairground. Now, contrary to what Hollywood will tell you, the observation decks were absolutely not repurposed flying saucers. I'll have you know, the pavilion was designed by the legendary American architect Philip Johnson, whose impact on modern architecture is especially abundant throughout New York. Now, not all of the state pavilions were quite as impressive as New York. As one news outlet reported,
they seem to be a collection of afterthoughts and the obvious, the work of governor's relatives.
Okay, so some of the pavilions were basic. Wisconsin boasted the world's largest cheese, which was rather obvious, but I think the architecture of the pavilion was actually kind of brilliant. Someone else must have thought so as well, because after the fair, the building was purchased and moved 1,000 miles to Neillsville, Wisconsin. Now, it might surprise you to learn that the Florida Pavilion was yet another venue met with mixed reviews. Despite offering guests an opportunity to interact with exotic birds like flamingos and cockatoos, go see a water ski show, and an incredible collection of artwork which guests could see for no charge, plus a live porpoise show which only cost a whopping $2.
Shake hands, old man, and wipe that grin off your face, or you're for the high jump.
The Florida Pavilion looked more like a resort, complete with a small beach home to a collection of bathing beauties.
Come on down.
Perhaps, if the pavilion could have boasted the world's largest orange, it might have brought out more guests. The Oregon Pavilion was one of the more popular venues at the fair, if you can believe it. For just $1, attendees could experience a show that included axe throwing, log rolling, and a pole climbing act that included real lumberjacks. At the Missouri Pavilion, guests could view the Spirit of St. Louis. That's the historic plane that Charles Lindbergh used to travel from New York to France on the first solo non-stop transatlantic flight. Lucky Lindy still had fans all over the world, so it was no surprise that so many people would want to see this historic aircraft. Of course, the state pavilion that Disney fans will most oftentimes talk about is the Illinois Pavilion. Illinois, you say? Isn't that the state full of cows and soybeans? And to you, I say, well, yes. But don't forget, Walt Disney was born in Illinois. People from Illinois may also be very quick to point out that the 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, spent much of his life in the state, and it's where he started his political career. Disney himself was always fascinated with Old Honest Abe. It's said that as a child, Walt could even recite the Gettysburg Address. When the World's Fair officials first met with Disney and discovered he had been working on an animatronic figure of Abraham Lincoln, they just knew it had to make it out to the fair. This led to the creation of Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln.
I think that people are going to be surprised how lifelike this Abraham Lincoln is going to be when they're going to sit in there and listen to this great man who gives a speech on liberty. And these are the speeches taken from Abraham Lincoln's own writings and speeches. And he's in a very dignified setting, and the audience is conditioned, and then they're presented to the president, and he stands up and addresses this audience. Well, by the way, on the Lincoln figure, we've done considerable research so that we really could create a lifelike impression of Lincoln. We're fortunate in being able to secure a life mask that was made of Lincoln. It was made in about 1860, I think. And it gave us a chance to know the contour of his face and all of that. And then by research, we found all of his mannerisms. We selected a voice that fit the closest to what was described as Lincoln's voice, and also how he used to start the speech. He'd start it rather high, then as he got into his speech, he would come down and modulate his voice more carefully. He was a fellow who could get rather emotional in the middle of a speech, too. So we've done everything we can to create the most lifelike image of Lincoln, more so than I think any actor could ever do.
Walt Disney's involvement in the Illinois Pavilion certainly helped to ensure its success. People were just astounded by how real the animatronic figure was. In addition, the pre-show did a really good job of pointing out that Illinois is more than just Lincoln's home state. The more research I did for this video, the more I wanted to learn about the 21st state. Then I thought to myself, who would people rather learn about Illinois from? Myself or the state's number one citizen? And now, ladies and gentlemen, the skills of a YouTuber and the talents of a voice actor will let us explore Abe's honest truth about the Prairie State.
Hey, what's the deal?
Don't worry, Donald. I found the problem.
Illinois gets its name from the native Illiniwek tribe and means ordinary speaker. There are roughly a dozen different tribes living in and around the state of Illinois. Illinois actually copyrighted the slogan, Land of Lincoln. Besides Walt Disney...
Hey there, Mr. President! How you doing? I hear you talking about my buddy Walt over here, so I thought I'd just jump right in.
Why don't you score out ahead?
Oh, gosh, thank you, Mr. President. So besides Walt Disney, a number of well-known personalities were born in the state of Illinois, including Robin Williams, the voice of Homer Simpson, Betty White, Harrison Ford, God, I love him, Jennifer Hudson, Mr. T, I pity the fool, Bill Murray, John Cusack, Bob Odenkirk, Jay Rulich, Charlton Heston, Gary Sinise, and Jennifer Morrison.
Illinois is also home to the Kaskaskia Dragon.
Let's see.
It's a 30-foot metal dragon that has been terrorizing tourists, as well as the residents of the Illinois RV Park.
Well, of course, Mr. President, the dragon isn't the only monster you'll find in Illinois. That job goes to Robin Goyovich.
Has anyone heard of the Tully Monster?
Weren't those strange fossils found in Illinois that represent the aquatic creatures that lived there about 300 million years ago?
By God, you're right.
Oh, here's my favorite. The world's largest bottle of catsup can be found on Route 66 in Collinsville, Illinois. Too bad they didn't make it out of the World's Fair.
At one time, soda was outlawed on Sundays in Illinois, creating a bit of a dilemma for your local soda jerk.
Well, if the soda was a jerk, maybe he had it coming to him.
Legend has it that this is what brought about the creation of the ice cream sundae.
And if you like sweets like me, you should know that the Twinkie was invented in River Forest, just outside of Chicago in 1930.
While Illinois' state dance is square dancing, state is also the official home of the International Polka Association.
Polka, polka.
Illinois also has the largest number of personalized license plates.
Just like you, Amy. Aren't you on the license plate?
Yes. But I must say, my friend, it's been a pleasure.
Of course. Thank you, Mr. President.
Pilots of the future will not be able to get their favorite ball game on this TV monitor. Closed-circuit television for safe aircraft and space vehicle landings. Another example of how NASA and General Electric are planning today for safe landings in the aerospace world of tomorrow.
And we might be inside it here at Idlewild, the airport where, by the million, people from all over the world, hey-ho, are coming to the fair.
Ah, another plane. Jeez.
Now it's time to grab our boarding passes for the fair's most popular unconventional carousel. Of course, I'm talking about the Big Top Carousel at the Festival of Gas. Oh, wait. You weren't looking to rotate around eight elegant horses in order to experience the past, present, and future of the gas industry? Then what were you looking for? Oh, so you were looking to learn about that carousel.
It might not look like much now, but right here behind me, this is the site of the Carousel of Progress.
Now, it's a theater that revolves. The people revolve around six stages. And on each one of these stages are my audio animatronic figures that enact a little part of the whole story. And we start with the pre-electrical age. We had coal lamps and all that, coal oil lamps. And we go up to early electrical, mid-electric, and then up to today and what you can do with electricity in your home. But the audience itself revolves around these fixed stages. And it's called the Carousel Theater of Progress.
While most carousels just go round and round without getting anywhere, in the one we're about to experience, at every turn, we'll be making progress. Progress is the sound of a motor, the hum of a turbine, the heartbeat of a factory, the sound of a symphony. Roar of a rocket. As far back as the 1950s, Walt Disney had been toying around with an attraction highlighting the idea of progress. Originally, it was meant to be the centerpiece of Edison Square, a new land plan for the Disneyland park in between Main Street and Tomorrowland. While Edison Square was never built, the idea stuck around and was revived for the New York World's Fair. The 64-65 World's Fair was dedicated to man's achievement on a shrinking globe in an expanding universe. Many of the attractions offered a glimpse into the future, or at least what the future was predicted to look like in the 1960s. The Carousel of Progress was a bit of a departure from the traditional formula. First off, the Carousel of Progress was the only stage show at the fair to feature 32 animatronic actors.
Well, they're not real people, but they are a talented and interesting cast. We call them audio animatronic figures, and they talk and act like human beings.
Contrary to human performers, these figures in the Carousel of Progress were required to operate nonstop all day without ever taking a break. Guests, on the other hand, got to relax in a circular theater specifically built to rotate audiences around a series of scenes, which depicted a typical American family over a series of decades. First, in the good old days leading up to the turn of the century, we were introduced to the Carousel family just before electricity entered the home. After that, it's off to the roaring 20s when electricity entered the home and brought some incredible advancements, ready to work at the click of a switch. Oh, hey, we blew a fuse. Guess it's time to move past the era of jazz and air cooling.
No privacy at all around this place.
Sorry, Orville. As I was saying, Next, the audience enters the fabulous 40s. Mother decorates a new rumpus room, and daughter Jane takes advantage of an electrical exercise machine.
Jane, are you going to the dance?
Yes, but I'm not going to the dance with that jerk Wilfred.
I don't blame you one bit.
Besides, I wouldn't be seen in his old jalopy. Makes me bounce and shake like a bowl of jelly.
In the final scene, the audience gets to celebrate Christmas in the 1960s with all the modern conveniences provided by your friends at General Electric. Fairgoers marveled at all the incredible advancements before exiting the theater and entering a time tube on a one-way trip to the gateway to future progress to get a glimpse at the future by General Electric. Guests could learn about fusion on Earth.
General Electric at San Jose, California, manufactured uranium dioxide pellets which provide heat to produce steam in the reactor. One of the world's most reliable power stations, Dresden shows the way to better and more economical generation of electric power.
Or visit Medallion City, an exhibit demonstrating interventions for the home, public, in industry, and space exploration. The Sky Dome Spectacular was particularly impressive. Visitors could discover mankind's historic efforts to harness energy. The Progress Land Pavilion, presented by General Electric, was tremendously popular. Almost everyone who visited the pavilion during the New York World's Fair left entertained and educated. They usually left with a catchy tune stuck in their head as well.
Shining at the end of every day.
It's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. And tomorrow, there'll be another plane.
Man has a dream, and that's the start.
He follows his dream in his mind and in his heart.
And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me.
It's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. Shining at the end of every day.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow.
And tomorrow is just a dream away.
That was kind of bad.
I don't know if that last part was actually on key or if it was following the tune, but you get the gist. I think I get it.
Richard and Robert Sherman have produced a number of songs for Disney attractions over the years, but this is perhaps my favorite. To help tell the story, they produced versions of the track inspired by each of the time periods that show up in the Carousel of Progress. The 20s sounded more like ragtime, whilst the 1940s felt a little bit more like swing. During the 1964-65 World's Fair, more than 12 million people experienced the Carousel of Progress. This ensured that the attraction needed to live on after the fair. In fact, it would move to the West Coast and become the anchor of New Tomorrowland alongside attractions like Adventures Through Inner Space and the updated Flight to the Moon. There were a few changes to the attraction at Disneyland, most notably the addition of an all-new post show where guests were invited to visit Disney's Progress City. Walt's vision of the future was the precursor to the experimental prototype Community of Tomorrow. Of course, Walt Disney passed away before that vision could become a reality. Sadly, he didn't even live long enough to see the Carousel of Progress open in Disneyland in 1967. General Electric would remain the sponsor during the attraction's six-year run in California. It would close in 1973 to make way for America Sings with Eagle Sam. Wrong Eagle. Thank you. It was a musical celebrating the US of A and took advantage of the carousel-style ride system. But that wasn't the end of Carousel of Progress, oh no. The attraction traveled back to the East Coast, this time settling at the Walt Disney World Resort in Florida. There were definitely some noticeable changes when it opened up in 1975. Many of the voice actors changed, including Father. Also, the final scene would now take place in the 1970s, and there was no post-show. Fans of Progress City would now need to board the People Mover in Walt Disney World in order to see the model. By far, the biggest change was the addition of a new song replacing the original. Our Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow was gone in favor of a new composition from the Sherman Brothers titled
Now Is the Time, Now Is the Best Time, Here and Right Now, Through Joy or Strife. There's so much to cheer for, be glad you're here for, it's the best time of your life.
Oh, I really like this song. Aww.
I do like the song a lot, but I think I prefer ours better to Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow because I feel like it makes more sense with the attraction because it's like now is the best time, but it's a carousel of progress, being like we progress and get better.
While the song has its following, many longtime fans were deeply offended by the change. Regardless, Now Is the Time would stick around for almost two decades. So during that time period, General Electric began talking about a brand new attraction for Disney World's second Florida park, Epcot Center. You see, when Walt Disney passed, his vision of the experimental prototype Community of Tomorrow evolved into something more like a World's Fair. Not unlike the one in Flushing Meadows where Carousel of Progress premiered. Disney Imagineers started working with GE on an attraction that would serve as the spiritual successor for Carousel. The attraction was called Horizons, and it opened in 1983.
And what I remember about Horizons is that it wasn't one of the first pavilions opened at Future World. It kind of came a few months later, and the futuristic scenes and kind of showing us where we're going. You had the underwater scene, you had the outer space scene, and you had the farming scene. The desert scene. One of the interesting things about Horizons, I was obviously, like many other people, sad when it was demolished, but I happened to actually be on the highway at the time when they were hauling off the ride vehicles. I saw them on the back of a truck and I got a few pictures of it being hauled away. So yeah, every time I pass by Mission Space now, I kind of lament the fact that Horizons isn't here anymore. It's kind of sad, really.
Many fans are also quick to point out the resemblance between the Horizons' two narrators and mother and father from the Carousel of Progress. With their new attraction up and running at Walt Disney World's newest park, General Electric felt like it was time to end their 20-year sponsorship of the Carousel of Progress. GE would continue their sponsorship of Horizons well into the 90s. The 90s also brought about some big changes for the Carousel of Progress. Tomorrowland and the Magic Kingdom was going through a major overhaul, transforming into the future that never was. During that time, the carousel would transform into the version that we are familiar with today. Gene Shepard joined the cast and took on the role of the father. Now, if that voice sounded familiar, he was also the narrator of the holiday classic, A Christmas Story.
Immediately, my feet began to sweat as those two fluffy little bunnies with the blue button eyes stared sappily up at me.
Fans were excited to find out the original song, It's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, was back. Grandma experiences virtual reality for the first time. Orville still can't find any privacy, and Rover lives to be 100 years old. That's 413 in dog years. The attraction was rebranded Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress, and now it's viewed more as a tribute to its creator. Although our carousel family has experienced a few changes over the years, the core of the show still revolves around the same theme, and that's progress.
Fun fact, when I was younger, instead of going to Disney and like dressing like Disney princesses, I went to Disney and I dressed like the grandma on the Carousel of Progress. I even had the VR glasses.
Now it's time to pack our bags for a quick trip to the Motor City. The world headquarters for the Ford Motor Company is located just outside of Detroit, Michigan. Leading up to the 1964-65 World's Fair, Henry Ford II was serving as CEO of Ford. The company already had a history of success at previous World's Fairs, including the 1933-34 World's Fair in Chicago and the 1939 World's Fair in New York. Ford knew that they had to come up with something really big for the 1964 World's Fair. In addition, it would give them an excellent opportunity to show off their newest model, the Ford Mustang.
This is the car that dreams are made of. So dream your own Mustang.
The company was going all out for their new American muscle car. It would appear in commercials and even film.
Well, this is as far as I go.
Yes, me too. This is my hotel.
What a coincidence.
Yeah, it's so convenient.
You look pale, Mr. Bond. I hope I didn't frighten you.
Well, you see, I've always been a nervous passenger.
Some men just don't like to be driven.
No, some men just don't like to be taken for a ride.
The car's sleek design would be a major selling point. The name Mustang actually has nothing to do with horsepower. It came from the P-51 Mustang fighter plane that was used in World War II. The Ford company was looking to do something really ambitious for the 1964-65 World's Fair. Officials from the fair had already met with Walt Disney in order to bring his unique brand of entertainment to Flushing Meadows. Henry Ford would approach Disney in order to build one of the biggest and most exciting pavilions at the fair. Of course, the competition was fierce. In addition to all of the state and country pavilions, a number of well-known names in the automotive industry would be present as well. For example, the United States Rubber Company brought out an 80-foot Ferris wheel shaped like a giant white wall tire. This architectural masterpiece was so incredible that after the fair, the tire would be taken down and reassembled in Allen Park, Michigan, right off of I-94. Ford's biggest competitor would have to be General Motors. Their eye-catching pavilion was so easily recognizable due to its enormous slanting canopy. People were excited to see some of the experimental cars that GM had on display. The most exciting aspect of the General Motors Pavilion was the new Futurama.
Welcome to Futurama 2. Welcome to a journey into the future. A journey for everyone today into the everywhere of tomorrow. Let us explore together the future. A future not of dreams, but of reality.
Attendees were invited to board a ride and experience what the future may look like. From the depths of the ocean to the icy landscapes of the Antarctic, and even the vast craters of the moon.
Lunar rovers float magically over powdered plains, range the crater's edge, their elastic train-like bodies conforming to every surface character of the moon.
But if the future's not your thing, the people at Sinclair Oil had their eyes set on the past. 165 million years in the past, to be precise.
Grand Betty, look! Look at all the people!
And the weird buildings! What is all this?
You got me. Well, there's a sign over there. It says, World's Fair. I guess we're back in Bedrock.
I don't know, Fred. I don't remember anything like that at our fair.
Wow!
Or that!
You're right! Or that!
Or that!
Dinoland was a large display full of life-size replicas of some of our favorite dinosaurs.
Youngsters and adults alike stand in awe of a world that was. Here, too, there are interesting favorites. Tyrannosaurus, king of the tyrant lizards. Not much on looks, maybe, but popular with many visitors. 50 feet from tip to tip, 20 feet high, fiercest creature that ever lived.
Interestingly enough, Ford and Disney had plans to bring their own dinos out to the World's Fair. Enter Ford's Magic Skyway.
With the Ford exhibit, we take them in a Ford product, and they ride back in time. And they go back to the primeval days with the big giant lizards, dinosaurs and brontosauruses and stegosauruses and all of that. And they're all animated and moving, very lifelike. And the Ford has a wonderful show of their product today and how it's designed and all of that. I think the Ford exhibit is going to be one of the top exhibits at the fair.
On January 21st, 1963, Ford announced they'd be working with Walt Disney to bring fairgoers a unique and exciting automobile trip through a fantasy land of the past, present, and future. The Ford Rotunda would be several city blocks long and contain enough steel to erect a skyscraper 125 square feet and 22 stories high. In addition to a number of special exhibits, people were invited to climb aboard a Ford-built convertible riding along a special roadway. The system developed for the Magic Skyway would go on to inspire the Omnimover system that would be utilized for classic Disney attractions like the People Mover.
The People Mover is a fantastic ride.
People Mover, yes. Amazing ride.
I just think it's great.
It's a ride that moves people through attractions.
At one point, they had changed the name to something else, and I remember thinking, was the Tomorrowland Transit Authority. No, it's the Wedway People Mover for Walt Elias Disney.
What more do you want than just a relaxing tour around a futuristic environment, going through a dark tunnel of Space Mountain?
The part where it's just like darkness and Space Mountain is a little bit terrifying, but 10 out of 10.
What I love about the People Mover is that you get to go in two of the rides, you get to see all of Tomorrowland and see the castle.
Once aboard the Skyway, attendees would travel back to the dawn of life on Earth.
So if your imagination is ready, here we go. We're traveling backwards in time, many millions of years, in fact, back to a day when giant creatures thundered over the land and soared like gliders across the sky.
The advanced animatronic dinosaurs you'd encounter in this part definitely gave the static figures of Sinclair's Dinoland a run for their money. The Disney staff made sure their larger-than-life lizards would be the finest at the fair.
These fellows are building a Tyrannosaurus Rex, weighing over 20,000 pounds. He'll be the heavy in our show Magic Skyway, a drama of prehistoric days.
Now, if those dinosaurs look at all familiar, that's because after the fair, these robotic reptiles move cross-country to Disneyland. Be sure to check out the Primeval World Diorama next time you board the Disneyland Railway.
Primeval World Diorama? That's at Disneyland, which is really cool.
There's a little part where it looks like you're going through the Grand Canyon, and then it's like, oh, you're traveling back in time, and then there's dinosaurs everywhere. It's really fun.
It's the part of the train, and then when you get to the part with the train, it has like little dioramas, and in one of them is a dinosaur and another dinosaur fighting. It's super, super cool. I enjoy it a lot.
One of the coolest things at Disneyland. Definitely, definitely a cool thing.
Our next stop on Ford's Magic Skyway is the Rise of Mankind. This is where Disney takes the opportunity to add a little trademark humor to the attraction. Similar to some of the goofy caricatures you might encounter on Pirates of the Caribbean, the cavemen you'd notice on the Magic Skyway were simple, but good-natured.
This was a strange new world, but man embarked on his adventure with a new power, the ability to think and reason. Before long, the caveman discovered how to harness nature's fire to cook his food and warm his, home. The things he learned, like fire making and language, were passed from father to son and to a friend in need. His hunting and tool making skills helped trap the woolly mammoth and gave his world its name, the Stone Age. Caveman recorded his adventures to posterity on the walls of his home, probably when his wife was out.
What makes this part even more interesting is the fact that we can visit similar show scenes today by hopping aboard Spaceship Earth in Epcot.
Spaceship Earth, yes, another favorite attraction.
I am a big fan of Spaceship Earth, but I can't wait till it gets a redo because I don't think the ride down now is worthy of anything.
Keep it as it is. I know it's going to go through a great big rehaul pretty soon, but that ride is spectacular.
I remember the old ride down where you would see all these things that we now have already, but they were technological at the time. You would have a mom from another country, I think, putting her child to sleep, and she wasn't near him. It was all video, and it was awesome. I really hope they make it technological again.
As someone who is really big into technology, one of my more favorite scenes is seeing that little guy in the garage working on his computer, and it kind of inspires me, really.
It's at this point the attraction becomes a bit more of a marketing campaign for Ford. One bright caveman starts to make a sales pitch for his latest, greatest invention, the wheel. You could say that this marks a huge milestone for the Stone Age, eh? And an important moment for the automotive industry. From there, your car travels through time once more, taking its passengers to the city of tomorrow. Imagine something similar to Walt's Progress City model that's on display at the Magic Kingdom. You'd slide along a super skyway surrounded by metal spires and glimmering bubble dome buildings before returning to 1964. Altogether, the Magic Skyway was considered one of the best attractions at the World's Fair. While General Motors had the most popular pavilion at the fair, most of the people polled preferred the Magic Skyway to GM's Futurama. This would be extremely disappointing to General Motors since they had spent around $55 million to ensure they'd be the number one attraction at the fair. In contrast, Ford's budget was around $25 million less than GM, and still pretty much equals GM's popularity, thanks in no small part to Walt Disney.
You know you're on television. You don't know about television, do you? I want you to look pretty. That's it. Get your head up and hold it there now. Show them how you behave. That's a good one.
But the story doesn't end there. Almost two decades later, General Motors would get the final one-up on Ford by signing a 10-year sponsorship deal for a new attraction coming to Disney World that would illustrate the history of transportation. The attraction was, of course, known as the World of Motion, and it opened in Epcot Center in 1982.
What the World of Motion? Now, I don't know what World of Motion is. I have no clue what World of Motion actually is.
Oh, I loved World of Motion. I did. I loved just the getting on the ride and then doing that spiral curve up. It built up anticipation. And the song that was in it about taking pictures and stuff. I loved World of Motion. There were so many animatronics inside, and the scenes were so elaborate.
I remember the whole street scene with the horse, and everybody's just like this huge accident there. And I loved it. And of course, the scene kind of going into the future, I really love that as well. And
have I been on the World of Motion? I was not born then, so no. No, I wasn't. But maybe, just maybe, if I had a time-traveling train that could hit 88 miles per hour, maybe I could go back on the ride and tell you guys how it is. But right now, that seems pretty much impossible.
Well, here we are at the Court of Nations, and our goodwill ambassadors from Disneyland are on hand to greet us.
All right, everyone. Looks like we only have one more attraction to discover. So get ready, because we'll be embarking on a journey to the Tower of the Four Winds in order to learn a bit more about the happiest cruise that ever sailed. Disney has always been good at reminding us that we live in a small, small world. The 1964-65 World's Fair was anything but small, seeing over 50 million people from across the globe visit Flushing Meadows. It should be no surprise then that the symbol of the 64-65 World's Fair was a 12-story stainless steel model of the Earth, known as the Unisphere.
The world in stainless steel, the Unisphere, as high as a 12-story building.
The monument was dedicated to peace through understanding, an idea that would prove extremely important during the 1960s. It was at a point in history when America's tension with North Vietnam were at an all-time high. Oh, and don't forget, just 1 year before his assassination in 1963, President Kennedy had to order a naval blockade in order to block the transport of nuclear missiles from Soviets to Cuba. The civil rights movement had become huge in America, prompting Martin Luther King Jr. to deliver his memorable "I Have a Dream" speech. Concepts like war and peace were on the minds of everyone, giving the Unisphere a great deal of importance at the fair. It must have had an impact too, because it's one of the handful of structures still present at Flushing Meadows today.
Some visitors with a faraway look in their eyes are particularly interested in exhibits of faraway lands and places. Exhibits that, through art, atmosphere, and architecture, bring pieces of the world to one World's Fair.
Now, initially, it proved somewhat difficult to motivate a variety of nations to join and participate in the 1964-65 World's Fair. You see, the New York's World's Fair was not sanctioned by the Bureau of International Expositions. The rules stated that only one exposition could take place every 10 years, and Seattle World's Fair had just taken place in 1962. That's just 2 years prior. This proves extremely problematic, since the blessing of the BIE would ensure the involvement of nearly 40 nations. Officials decided to move forward without the endorsement of the Bureau and reached out to a number of smaller nations. Some of the nations that did make it out to the New York World's Fair included Spain, Japan, Mexico, Sweden, Ireland, Greece, Denmark, Austria, Thailand, and the Philippines. Interestingly enough, members of the beverage industry were present in the international pavilions as well.
I want to get off.
You can't get off. We have five more continents to visit.
Fairgoers could visit Coca-Cola Tower. It was a three-sided spire containing the world's largest caroling.
The biggest always has an appeal to some of us. And here is the world's largest electronic carillon, more than 600 bells.
Visitors were also welcome to enjoy the global holiday, a 15-minute stroll through recreations of the streets of Hong Kong, the Cambodian forest, a Bavarian ski lodge, an Indian garden, and Rio de Janeiro. Time magazine called the Coca-Cola Pavilion the fair's best trip of all. Forbes magazine called it an almost magical transition through sights, sounds, and smells. After the World's Fair, the entire pavilion was disassembled. However, Coca-Cola moved the beautiful carillon to Stone Mountain in Georgia. That's where you can hear it today. Now, while I prefer the cool, refreshing taste of Coca-Cola, even I have to admit that 7-Up's International Sandwich Garden was pretty impressive as well. Yeah, and yes, that's a real thing. The garden provided an oasis from the rest of the fair with an incredible menu featuring a selection of sandwiches from 16 countries, plus all the 7-Up you can drink. There was an estimated 5 million people who visited the International Sandwich Garden during the World's Fair. That's around 10% of the fair's total attendance. The centerpiece of 7-Up's International Sandwich Garden was a futuristic tower that stood 107 feet above the pavilion. As part of the company's marketing, they invited friends from around the world to visit their pavilion with their slogan, "Let's meet under the 7-Up clock." Not to be outdone, Pepsi-Cola decided to embark on their own international exploits. They decided to collaborate with Walt Disney on a special attraction to serve as a salute to the children of the world and UNICEF. They brought in artists, engineers, musicians, costume designers, architects, and craftsmen in order to create one of the most popular attractions of all time.
Our exhibit, called It's a Small World, is a salute to the United Nations Children's Fund, a worldwide organization that is working for a better tomorrow by helping the children of today.
It's a tribute to the children of the world, and it's a little fantasy where you take a trip around the world of children in a boat, and you visit all the different countries with all the different children of these countries in their costumes, and a lot of toy-like figures to represent other things, and these little figures dance and sing, and finally end up with a big finale, which is like the finale in any musical, where all the children from these other lands that you've visited are all together in one, all singing in unison, and it's a big spectacular finish.
Hope we have some good winds back there in New York. This little mobile is a scale model of our Tower of the Four Winds that stands at the entrance to the UNICEF Pavilion at the World's Fair.
With all of the competition amongst the international pavilions, Disney wanted some sort of icon to pull in fairgoers. Walt Disney enlisted the help of Disney artist Raleigh Crump. Crump had already helped design the Adventureland Bazaar and the Enchanted Tiki Room over at Disneyland. Now it was time for him to bring his signature style to the fair. He wound up designing what would become the centerpiece of the Pepsi-Cola Pavilion.
All the Mobile's figures are driven by the Four Winds.
The Tower of the Four Winds was a 120-foot-tall spinning mobile. Actually, it was more like 52 mobiles in perpetual motion.
Mobile represents the boundless energy of youth.
The tower was a colorful and eye-catching addition to the pavilion. Pepsi even took a cue from 7-Up and came up with their own slogan.
So when you visit the fair, ask your friends to meet you under the Tower of the Four Winds at our pavilion here.
Pepsi-Cola tasked WED Enterprises with building an attraction for their pavilion. The catch was, they only had just over 10 months to do it. Walt decided to take on this real Pepsi challenge and settle on a little boat ride. It needed to be something simple, endearing, and memorable. For help with the overall look and design, Walt looked to his animation department and brought in the legendary Mary Blair.
Who the f*** is Mary Blair?
Oh, I love Mary Blair. She is one of my favorite artists to work with Disney.
I just think her designs are so original. They're so full of life and they're just gorgeous.
It seemed like a lot of her artwork is kind of in that classic Disney style that I really like.
And behind me is one of her most famous pieces. It's a huge mural right here in Disney's Contemporary Resort.
Seeing that big mural in the, you know, of the tiles and trying to find the five-legged goat in the Contemporary. And I remember going to It's a Small World and thinking that the style was familiar. I don't even know how to describe it, but you can definitely go from one to the other and go, that's Mary Blair. So there's definitely something in her style and color palette that even a child can definitely pick up on and just know that there's some connection to.
Blair brought her colorful, whimsical style to Flushing Meadows in order to design the happiest cruise that ever sailed. Of course, she couldn't do it alone. She'd team up with Disney legends like Raleigh Crump, Mark and Alice Davis, as well as sculptor Blaine Gibson. Inside the 12-minute attraction, visitors could glide by the Eiffel Tower, Dutch windmills, and the Taj Mahal. Animated figures of children dance, sing, and play in some of the most colorfully designed scenes you are likely to experience anywhere in the world.
Our musical fantasy features the songs and dances of youngsters from more than 100 nations, each singing in his own native language.
Originally, Pepsi brought up the idea of having animatronic children singing their national anthems respectively. However, that proved to be far too difficult. Walt would turn to his longtime collaborators, the Sherman Brothers, to come up with a simple, catchy tune. With just a few months before the fair, the boys didn't waste any time. What they came up with was one of the most iconic Disney tracks of all time.
The song, It's a Small World. It's a Small World is a great song.
Does it get stuck in your head? Yes. Is it a bad song? No.
Yeah, most people actually find it kind of annoying, but I actually very much enjoy the song.
With lyrics such as, it's a world of laughter, a world of tears.
It's a world of hope and a world of fears.
There's so much that we share and it's time we're aware. It's a small world after all.
It it's a small world after all.
It's a small world after all.
It's a small world after all.
It's a small, small world.
If you really enjoyed the track, Disney produced records and sheet music for fairgoers that they could take home as souvenirs. It's a Small World would prove to be one of the most successful attractions at the 1964-65 New York World's Fair. Around 10 million tickets were sold, with proceeds going to UNICEF. Once the fair had ended, Disney had to decide what to do with their attractions. Small World would move across country to Anaheim. Since Pepsi was already sponsoring the Golden Horseshoe Review, Bank of America would step in and sponsor the attraction. The Disney version would see a number of improvements, especially to the attraction's exterior, which looks something like a huge white Mary Blair-inspired cathedral. The attraction would open in 1966 and was the last new Disneyland attraction Walt would live to see open.
The dedication ceremonies were attended by consular officials, representatives of the press, and thousands of Disneyland visitors. But the very special guests were children from many nations.
I used to have nightmares about getting stuck on It's a Small World, and everything was quiet, and all of the dolls were still and motionless. And I'd get off the boat and I'd be wandering around the facade and like having this panic within me because I knew I'd have to spend the rest of my life there. Is that normal? Does everyone have that?
America would change quite a bit in the years to come, becoming a bit more cynical.
It is a small world. In fact, we're still looking for the family that was lost and missing on It's a Small World, so if anybody has any information about that, please make sure you let me know.
People became increasingly critical of Small World's simple message of unity. In addition, it became more and more popular to mock the attraction's title track.
It's a small world after all.
No! No! Anything but that.
Despite all its haters, Small World's popularity guaranteed its presence in future Disney parks like Florida, Tokyo, Paris, and Hong Kong. However, the Anaheim version still has the distinction of being the original displayed at the World's Fair. While attractions like Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln and the Carousel of Progress have seen dramatic changes over the years, the voyage you'll take on It's a Small World in Disneyland feels very much the same as it did at Flushing Meadows. Maybe that's because more than five decades after the New York World's Fair, a simple ride featuring the little children from all nations coming together and singing in brotherhood doesn't need state-of-the-art technology to remain relevant. Perhaps the message of peace through understanding is just as important today as it was 50 years ago. All right, everybody, I want to thank you so much for checking out this documentary on Disney's involvement in the 1964-65 New York World's Fair. Now it's your turn to get involved. We want to know, which of these attractions did you think was most interesting? And how would you like to see the return of huge international exhibits like the World's Fair? Tell us all about it in the comments section below. We also need to thank all of the incredible people who helped and worked to make this documentary possible. If you'd like to find out more about these personalities, make sure to check the description of this video. And if you enjoyed this video, click the like button and subscribe to Retro Spectrum.